For my ears, these instruments, the gongs made out of this lovely metal, are really playing the music of the interplanetary spaces rather than music of the Earth. In fact, I heard a member of the audience say, it sounds like outer space. I mean, this is very true, because when the music of the spheres that reaches the Earth, something happens to it. The tones are buried in matter. All around us, every piece of matter, they all have tones in them. And we can hear when we tap something what the substance is, its density, its relative weight, and so forth. And the tones even reside in our own language, you know, in the sounds we make, the consonants. A b will always sound lower pitch than a p, and a g than a k. These musical tones, when they reach the earth, something happens to them. And now what I have here is a harp, an instrument on which one can play music, an art form. And in this talk, I'd like to look for the connection between art, music, nature, and plants. And first of all, as it's a huge subject, I'm going to approach it from several sides rather than attempt to go through it in a linear fashion. First of all, in respect of art, I'm very struck by Goethe's comment that in art, it is the intentions that are important. This is what we really identify as giving a piece of a work of art some magic. However, perhaps imperfectly, it is realized. It's the intentions. Now, all the arts in the world, virtually all of them, have models in the physical world. The artist works from ideals, the painter from colors and forms, the dramatist from situations that he's heard of or invented or derived from other sources. The sculptor from forms around him or her. Now, it doesn't mean you have to do only representational work. You can combine elements to make non-representational work. But in terms of the archetypes, this is true of all the arts except music. With music, we cannot look for models outside in nature, not really. We have to draw the music from ourselves, unless, of course, we copy another musician. And with everything except music, the artist forms mental images and chooses elements to make the work of art. Okay? Now, Schopenhauer, a very interesting 19th century luminary, said that the artist reproduces the archetypal pictures of the will of nature. But bear in mind, these are the pictures, but not in music, because tone is a direct expression of the will of nature. It's not a picture of it. It's a direct expression. And because of this, because we don't have to form mental pictures, because it's the actual will of nature that we hear in musical tones, music can therefore affect every body, whether you're a baby in the womb, or a babe in the pram, or a child or an adult. Music can have effects. It can be very powerful for healing, for changing your mood, for making you spend more in the supermarket. So tone is a direct expression of the will. And if we have our ear to this, we can realize that music also affects plants and is known to affect animals as well. But particularly, research has been done on its effects on plants. Now, that music of the gongs we heard It is music that floats and creates images of vast spaces. It's, for me, the gongs are not instruments of the earth. They are like the sun radiating out an incredible energy, which comes to meet us on the earth. And as it reaches the earth, it changes. And one of the interesting discoveries long ago by Pythagoras, amongst others, is that when we play a long string, harmonics are created on it. This, if you like, is a natural fact. And the same thing occurs when we blow a long pipe. You get a series of harmonics. You get the octave, you get the fifth, you get another octave, you get the third, you get another fifth, you get a seventh, another octave. And in fact, through purely natural substances, we create the major scale. A scale which naturally wants to rise up. The diatonic scale, do, re, mi, is formed purely out of harmonics that are found in long strings and pipes. And that's been known for thousands of years, and various musical systems have been developed from it. But if you buy a flute in India or in China, it'll still have this basic scale as part of, as the notes on the flute. There will be variations, but that's the underlying pattern. It's found all over the world because this basic fact of the harmonics is found all over the earth. And now another picture I'd like to present to you. Here we are, we're living surrounded by plants and in the mineral kingdom and with the animals. We have four kingdoms. And I like this little mantra. In the mineral realm, the gods sleep. In the plant realm, the gods dream. In the animal realm, the gods wake. And in the human realm, we have the capacity to think. Now, these realms are accomplished, finished facts. They're the result of creative work created by beings who, unlike humanity, unlike us, do not now appear on Earth. And evolution currently is taking place in the human being, as I'm sure we all surmise. Now, only we humans possess a consciousness that can deny the divine. Only human beings are really capable of thinking about what has been created. And so thinking represents a new phase in the evolution of the earth. And that's why we're all here today, to enjoy some thinking. Now, the material realm, which is really the only one that humanity has mastered today, out of which all of our buildings and cars and things are made, has the quality of condensation. It condenses, it's hard. And let's say the gods are deeply asleep in that substance. In plants, we see vitality. That is what they express everywhere. The animal, the primary aspect is really desire. And we have all these characteristics, on top of which is thinking. I'm talking in very broad strokes here, because I know time is limited. So the plant is vitality. And really, we have a very reciprocal relationship with the plant covering of the planet Earth. When we look at the human being, we can even see ourselves as a form of plant. In fact, for the Greeks, they could see trees within us. If you've seen the anatomical drawings, you'll know what I mean about the blood, the capillary system, about the nervous system. And even our lungs are like two inverted trees. When we have this tree trunk here, the brachia, and the lungs. It's like an inverted tree which lives, all of our lungs live in a reciprocal relationship with the trees, which they are like reversed images of. Now the plants respond to the seasons and to the surrounding, the warmth, the light, the air, the water. And the plants link heaven and earth, which in a way is what I'm doing here, playing this instrument, which is an earth instrument, just after those unearthly gongs. So plant life is growth, and it's an image of life in the book of nature. And we all of us eat plants, even the meat eaters, because we tend to eat vegetarian animals. What we do then is get the vegetation secondhand. It's the vegetables, the plants, that really give us our vitality. Theosophists would say that, and anthroposophists would say that the plants are the embodiment of the etheric forces. And that with the animal comes the astral, the desire. Now I'm going to come around to plants in this way. You know, inorganic nature, when it comes to materials, all the elements can be perceived by the senses. We can look at stones and metals and so forth and see the substance. And furthermore, if we, say, throw a stone against some mud, it will make an indentation, and we can understand the force involved and what has happened in the mud. One thing leads to another in the inorganic realm. Now, moving quickly to the plant kingdom, we cannot say that one thing causes another in that way. We can't say, for example, that the position or the size of the root will determine the form of the stem or the leaves and the flowers. And no more can the stem determine what shape the flower will be when it appears, or the fruit. So that the plant appears to be an organism over which there is some sort of higher unity hovering, which produces the various elements. And so it's not immediately perceptible to the senses. And we have to think about this. We have to think about what it is that can do this. Now for Goethe, he saw thought as a spiritual activity and a spiritual perception of the archetypes. He didn't see thought merely as an affair going on inside our own heads. He saw it as a perception of the spiritual. Okay? Now, he identified some very interesting aspects of plant morphology, and this involved a type of thinking which saw the unity of the plant between heaven and earth. Okay? So in order to explain the plant, we have to conceptualize, and we make a sort of separation between the object we perceive and the concept that we come to explain it. There appears to be a separation, but in reality, there is none. The separation occurs in our own consciousness, rather. Goethe was opposed to observing by methods which destroyed life. He believed in the necessity for a higher way of looking at these things. And he came to a theory of metamorphosis, which has been proven time and again by modern scientific methods. Okay. Now, one of the interesting things about plants is, although we're told that we live in a realm here on Earth where gravity pulls everything down, plants really constantly disprove that. The power to grow up against gravity is, for example, in trees, one of the most powerful forces around us. You know, ruins, large stone ruins, can be broken in time by the force that lifts plants out of the ground. If you've ever seen people who've laid tarmac down and they haven't cleared all the weeds, it doesn't matter how thick the tarmac is, after a while, plants will erupt through the tarmac. That really is an immense force. And yet the plant, when it starts, is a very tender, fragile organism. So we're not saying that a huge tree trunk erupts through the tarmac or pushes the stones apart in the ruins of the Aztec temple. No, it's a very soft, fragile organism, and yet it can do it. So we mustn't think of plants as if they were based upon centric forces. Centric forces we find in the mineral kingdom. When we light a piece of, you know, a fragment of gunpowder and it explodes, or some flammable material, that is a centric force. There are many examples of this, but the plant is quite different. Something, although it's very fragile, something is pulling it up with enormous force. And I would like to suggest that this is what pulls us up as well, which is why we don't feel gravity unless we're not well. Okay. Now, the thing that thrusts up from a plant is not, as you might expect, spear-like, to push its way up through, let's say, the tarmac, or even through the dark earth in which the seed has been placed. It's not a spear. In fact, there's always a little concave part at the top. It's actually hollow. It's like a chalice. You can find this in any book on botany. You'll see that the shoot that comes up out of the seed has a hollow top. It's like a chalice, like a wine glass, and it's reaching out to hold and catch the light, which of course is what happens eventually with the flowers and leaves. So this is an immense force which, for want of a better word, we call levity, which works against gravity. It's the same force that works in liquids, by the way, which makes water evaporate constantly, and in fact any liquid left will evaporate in time. The surface of the water is always wanting to break up and rise. Okay. Now, when we look at a plant, and I'm going to describe the stages of it in some detail in a minute, we see that it opens up and rises. And each plant and the variations of them is like a picture of higher development from the root coming upwards, from the root in the earth. We see a steady increase in quality. As the plant moves up from the earth, it becomes more specialized. The leaves and so on become more delicate and beautiful. And finally, in the flower, we have a polarity with the seed. The seed is the minimum shape, it's the contraction, and the flower is the great expansion. Now, I'm going to play you through this scale which you've all heard so many times. It's called Do, Re, Mi. And explain what I think happens. We've heard it so often that let's hear it again. And there is a verse, by the way. The Gregorians used to sing this scale before they began their choral work proper. And they had a verse which is the origin of Do, Re, Mi. I should explain that because it's not Do, a deer, a female deer. It's like this. The verse in English, the verse is, "In order that thy servants may sing with liberated vocal cords, pardon the offenses of the lips which have become earthly, Saint John." And the verse in Latin is "Ut reent laxis resonare fibris mira gestorum famili tuorum solve polluti labiae reatum sancto Ioannis." And the first word is "Ut re mi fa sol la si." This is it. I'll sing it for you. "Ut re and laxis resonare fibris mira gestorum famili tuorum solve polluti labiae reatum sancto Ioannis." Now that little song it comes from a time when the brothers saw music as an outpouring of the divine world, much as we've heard with the gong sounds. And now I'm going to play this primal scale for you and describe something. First of all, you can hear my description, and then we'll go through it with the plant archetype. This is the prime, this is do. And when we hear this, it's like a resting in oneself. We are ourself and the world are in a harmony. They correspond. And we trust and we can sleep. So we can relax in this peaceful, dreamy state. Now I'm going to go to the next note. Now here we have a dreamlike movement. And there is some tension now created, a sense of expectation. A movement, perhaps of water or vegetative. In that tension, we could perhaps imagine dreaming something, whereas the previous state was dreamless. And now, in the third, we experience soul, warmth, and a sense of waking up. And if you like, the light grows stronger. And now we come to the fourth. Now this is clearer. We're more awake. And we are gathered together with a greater tension. There's more of a concentration in this state, a sense of contraction, and also a greater sense of self. You're being made awake more strongly. And now we're going out of ourselves, opening up. I'd like to suggest that this could be a loving state and expansion. Being able to open your arms wide. And now we come to the sixth. And now the soul experience expands again, and this is more joyous. And we have experience of the greater, wider world. Could almost be limitless and euphoric. And now we come to the seventh. And this is an interval called the devil's interval in some ways, which is, it tears at you, it's very intense. There's a sense of movement, imprisonment as well. You want to break out. And find the octave. And here in this octave, we rediscover ourselves in a higher stage. We've achieved something. We've made an achievement. And in terms of the plant, which I will now describe again, we've come to a new prime, perhaps the seed of the next plant. Now this seven-note scale I've played for you is very much an archetypal journey which can be seen in our lives, in our destinies, in many things. It's also even the hero's journey, for those that are familiar with Joseph Campbell. It's really in there. So, now I'm going to describe for you the plant stages. It's actually got an interesting rhythmical pattern, the archetypal plant. And it's this that we see every time we look at a tree or a plant, a flower, a weed, even the moss grown on the roof. There's a rhythm of expansion and contraction. The greatest contraction occurs in the seed. And there's the seed in the ground, in the dark. And then the seed expands. And you may like to know that when the seed breaks open, the part that thrusts forward is actually more leaf than anything, more leaf than stem. And so, the leaf and the leaf-bearing shoot emerge from the seed, and they spread apart more and more. And they rise. And then, this is the stem appearing, if you like, in the light, with the leaves appearing on it here in the third. And then there's the sense of contraction that comes with the fourth. This is the contraction into the calyx on the stalk, followed by an expansion into the expansion of the petals from the corolla. And the petals are finer and more delicate than the sepals on the calyx, which means there's a continuous process of refinement occurring on the plant. And then there's a greater expansion and then we come to the seventh. Which is the concentration into the plant's sex organs, the stamens and the pistils. And then they expand into the fertilized ovary of the fruit. And there, in that full octave, at the top again, you have the repeat of the lower note. It's rediscovered in its higher form, which is the seed once again. So there you have a picture found in a force of nature which is musical, these scales, which is mirrored to some extent in the archetypal development of the plant, every plant. The polarity of the seed and the flower is like an image of the contrast between the earth and heaven. On the earth it contracts, and the forces of heaven pull it forward, pull it out, pull it towards the light. And that's the beautiful the flower, which is like a sort of image of the stars, of the planets and the patterns. You know, the movements of the planets is mirrored in many of the beautiful shapes of flowers and petals. So the combination of the earth and the cosmos produces this rhythm of contraction and expansion. And each time the pattern happens, the materials are refined. And it's therefore, each plant, if you like, is an image of a spiritual development, started in the earth, in the roots, and then rising up and branching out with the leaves, which are the green, usually the green pattern, and then eventually producing the flower with its wonderful cosmic colours. Now, the flowers and plants are all variations on a theme. The variations occur side by side. In the plant itself, we see metamorphoses are happening, and the difference is that the metamorphoses occur in time. And in the plant, we can see all of them at the same moment. In terms of our own personal metamorphoses, we leave them behind. We don't continue to look like the baby or the toddler or whatever. The same with the animal kingdom. The transformation is complete, but with the plant kingdom, we can see the process laid out in front of us of the roots in the earth, the rising up and the flowering, and the reaching towards heaven. Now, curiously, because of the way we have evolved, the plants live in us, as I said early on. I'm not a Darwinian. I think song before speech, which is what the Gregorians believed, flutes before blowpipes, and harps before bows. We have a divine origin, and the process of evolution on the earth has meant that we have inherited the mineral kingdom within us, obviously particularly in the bones. We have inherited the plant kingdom in these beautiful trees within us, which are the circulatory system, the nerves, the lungs. All over the body we can find trees and plants. And of course, children are very used to being trees at school and using their arms like branches and flowers. We can see the plants within all of us. In fact, we are an inverted plant. That is one of the esoteric significances of the cross, the Christian cross, in that what starts as a plant and then moves to an animal, with a horizontal backbone, if you like, then it turns right over to become the human being. And we are inverted plants. If you imagine a human being upside down with the head buried in the earth and the limbs, you would have a sort of picture of a plant, wouldn't you? But with us, we have the trunk, we have our branches, and between our legs, earthwards, pointing, we have our organs of desire, our flowers, which the flowers, being chaste, open up towards heaven. But ours, with earthly desires, are directed downwards. What you think of that, but yes, our earthly flowers of reproduction are pointing down towards the earth, but we have, because we're human beings and we are on a path of evolution, we have another womb, if you like, all of us, which is here in the vocal cords. This is where we can give birth to the word, to the sounds. In the beginning was the word. We're all destined to become, obviously, speakers of the word, of the sounds, which will call things into existence. It's interesting that the Greeks, as I say, they particularly saw this element of the trees within us. Our lungs, these lovely trees here, they, when we're at rest, we breathe about 18 times a minute on average. And another tree, which is our blood circulatory tree, that pulse is average of 72 beats a minute. There's a ratio there of 4 to 1. And I think it's quite significant, really, that 4 to 1 is a type of stability in music. It's a type of rhythm that is very reassuring for us. It's found all over the world, of course. It's one of these facts of the human organism, with all of its variations, that our blood and breathing are 4 to 1. Also, the Greeks saw the human being and the pulsing of the blood and the nerves of the spine as the lyre of Apollo. Really, they saw us human beings as the instruments of the gods. Much as the Christians would say, you know, we have to do the work, be the hands of the angels and do our work. So the Greeks saw us as a beautiful musical instrument in which the lyre of Apollo was placed. There are certainly musical elements in our structure, as there are in the plants. We can see, for example, how if we take do starting here, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, and we come to the seventh note at the fingertips. In other words, the octave is not here in space. We have a seven-stage development here in the arms and hands, mirrored in the legs. And curiously, we have two bones here in the forearm, the major and minor. So we can go do, re, mi, do, re, mi. We have musical structure there, and we can draw other analogies in terms of our skeletal shape. And now, let's look for a moment at Indian music. And any music which has a note like this that runs through it, it's called the ground. And Indian music particularly likes this sort of... The presence of the ground in music is what distinguishes the music I've just been playing, those tones, from the gongs. Because with the music that I've just played, you have a tonality which gives you a sort of center or a ground on which the music is based. And all music was really like this until the experiments in the 20th century with atonal music. I'm not saying, by the way, that people didn't play gongs and hear the music of the spheres in that way, but the music that we have created has had this ground element, which represents, if you like, God or the earth or some point from which we start off and may return. And that is why, when I played that scale, of course, the plant is rooted in the ground. It has to be. So when we play music that has this very primal structure to it, found in nature, I believe that it has a healing and organizing principle which we can benefit from. It's a very natural structure. Listen to this, for example. Just a set of simple chords in the major key, which for me has a sort of natural aspect to it. It's found in variations in countless tunes, that progression. And it's as natural as a flower, I think. It really is. It's got ratios which are very simple, for no art can be as easily demonstrated mathematically as music. And of course, when we see the numbers, we don't hear the music, but it could be shown how this little progression, which begins from a point and ends on the same point, in fact, I think I stopped an octave higher, is a natural progression. It brings us into ourselves in the same way, I think, that beholding nature does. I'm not saying you have to listen to harp music or anything like that. You've all got your tastes. But music can bring us into our archetype, and some of it can music can take us away from it. For example, the electronic music is like an artificial stimulant. The music that is based upon pure electronic impulses that can be sometimes played at a speed no musician could manage. This is an artificial type of sound. It's organized sound, and it's very stimulating for people that like it and want to go to clubs and hear it. Interestingly, when that music is played to plants, their growth is affected badly. The plants that can bend away from the loudspeakers that are producing that music. They don't thrive on it. Okay, so the plant is, let's say this, the taste of the plant, to have plants have good taste. They try to bend themselves away from the loudspeaker, and of course if they had legs, they'd run for it. Of course, human beings' tastes can be corrupted ad infinitum. So people can love things which are really bad for them. We all know that. But the plants, no. And for myself, I look at music as a sort of dietary subject in some ways, as does the Muzak Corporation. I mean, they want you to not notice what you're feeding on when you go into the supermarket, but be affected nonetheless. I like to be quite conscious about the effects of different parts of music. And the scales which are based on these natural manifestations of pipes and strings will always make us feel a sort of inner contentment, I think, if we're in the mood for it. Like a resting within oneself, and then a short journey. And as you know, there's music that can take you to all sorts of strange places, which can lift you into your higher self, which can lift you out of your body, as in the case of the lovely sounds from the gongs. Or there's music that can take you right into the body when you go boogieing and you want to just shake your buttocks about as much as possible. Music can be directed to different parts of the human being. And in fact, all the instruments individually reach different parts of us. We are like wonderful orchestras. As I say, the Greeks saw the lyre of Apollo within us, but we have other instruments there too. And the music that we make reflects the structure of the human being. In the bass, the walking bass, or any bass actually, that can... You have the legs or the feet walking along. And that is, it's very rhythmical. That's the lower part of the body walking along in the rhythms and in the bass particularly. We tend to hear notes that are low as coming from down below and very high notes from up there. And with the gongs, you know, you're hearing frequencies of all types. Very, very low and incredibly high too. So it's a really massive spectrum of tone there. When we hear the chords, what we have here is primarily feelings. These conjure up dreamy sensations of feelings. when we hear a melody line, you hear a little train of thought, like someone telling you something quite quickly. This is lines of thought, a little story. I found it in the end. So there you have thoughts, our thought life in the melodies, our feelings in the harmonies, and our rhythms in the bass and the percussive element. And in terms of the musical world, we have that in the instruments that play melodies, the harmony instruments, and rhythms. The harp, as I say, is seen by the Greeks, was seen, as an example of this combination of heaven and earth, and the strings stretching between the two that produce the tones. Here you have the earth, here you have the great curve of the vault of heaven, and here you have the pillar separating the two. And so what you have in the instrument of the harp is a window through which the cosmic music can appear. But the instrument is on earth, so on earth it becomes affected by the divine geometry that we find underlying forms on the earth. And that includes us, the plants, and the musical scales. And I think that brings me just about to the end of what I was going to say. And we've got 10 minutes left. I could play you some tunes, or do you have any questions? Play some tunes, okay, fine. Okay, I've rambled on far too long. Okay, let's have some Celtic music, which I love. And for me, this music is music which always has a tinge of sadness to it, because it's about those people, from those people who saw the loss of the vision of the spiritual world. They knew it, they knew they had seen it, and we had, as a human race, to enter a time when it became more difficult to see. But also, they said, as the gods left, and they couldn't see the gods and the angels and the little people quite so easily, as they left, the gods deposited some presents for humanity, some gifts. And they were the musical instruments. The gods left the instruments to remind them, to remind us of how to hear once again the heavenly music. And I like to think that with the folk music that we hear from different parts of the world, you can hear something of the natural environment in the music. With the Irish music, you can hear the running waters, the endless rain and the running streams. Go to South America, where it's very lush and things grow with wild, with incredible force, we can have this. Thank you for listening.